Yeah, we've been running a couple of years of nitrogen trials out in the lower rainfall areas with the GRDC project that got up a few years ago. And nitrogen's quite a broad subject, and there are lots of things we could get into. But what we want to concentrate on today is can you delay top-up nitrogen until your canola crop is flowering in the low rainfall? With some qualifiers, we want to concentrate it in the low rainfall areas with the low rainfall rates of nitrogen. So today we'll spend a lot of time talking about 25 or 30 units of nitrogen. So those are sort of the rates that economically farmers will end up at if indeed they are applying nitrogen, as we'll get into. So with those qualifiers, going back to the question, can you delay nitrogen top-up until flowering, we think the answer is yes. And I'm going to do the 2013 experiment, Santa, and a little bit of commentary overall in terms of nitrogen response. And then Sally joined in February 2014 and was involved in the 2014 trial, so she'll touch base on the 2014 results. And then I'll pop back and do a bit of a wrap-up. So why did we actually start the work? I guess in the low rainfall, there's not many things you can adjust once you've decided on your seed and your variety and you've sown it. You've got to control weeds, because otherwise why grow canola? You've often have to deal with high insect loads, and so you really have to manage those. So fertiliser and nitrogen is one of those things that you may want to think about mucking around with. And it is a major input cost from a dollar with urea or a kilo for nitrogen up to about $1.50 or more for Flexien and UAN. So it can be a relatively high part of the cost for farmers. And we know that the low rainfall environment is not always kind to canola, and you're not always assured of getting a crop. Yeah, and you're not always assured of getting an economic crop, and so trying to save money is something that people will always consider. And we also know that most people are sowing sometime in April with canola, and they're using very early to early mid varieties in those environments. And so from those sowing dates, the crop is basically right into flowering by the middle of July. So you've still got, at that time, even the low rainfall, some length of season for the plant to react to some management. And we also know, as Marty, those who came and saw the wide row talk, what a flexible crop canola is and how it can respond and react to a lot of mishaps or low densities and all those sorts of things and insect attack. It's quite amazing how it can recover. So it's not all of those things combined make you think, well, let's see if we can just delay the decision on nitrogen till we know we've got a crop, and even have the option of not putting it on if the seed's not turning, not spending the money. But if you do decide to go later, we really want to find out, have you done some dough in doing that? So just in a general couple of examples, this is Salmon Gums 2013, a pretty good site at, in our part of the world, one of the better years. But on the chart, I've got nitrogen that we applied and grain yield, and then at the bottom, I've also got the soil nitrogen plus the applied N. So organic carbon, about 0.8%, a couple of cereals and then a canola before this crop was sown in the years leading. It's only got about 40 of N from the soil. But in that year, a lot of it was mineralised because of the conditions. And so even with none applied, you're getting 900 kilos per hectare. But you are getting a nitrogen response up to about 75 in terms of grain yield, and it's flattening out after that. So yes, as we know, canola growth, certainly, biomass and yield does respond to nitrogen in a lot of situations. What also happens, and it happens often quite dramatically in WA, is that the oil drops as you increase nitrogen, and sometimes that's really quite steep, particularly if you get a plateauing out of the yield, then that becomes even steeper. So the drop in oil as you put on nitrogen, and the cost of the nitrogen as you're putting on higher rates, and the flattening of the grain yield response as you're putting on more nitrogen, ends up with gross margins that sometimes look like this. So this site, this is actually one of our more responsive sites, and it's 50 units of nitrogen in terms of the treatment that we put on. That was the best return for your investment. But you can see it just flattens out after that because of the cost and also the continuing decrease in the oil. So it's something to bear in mind. So just going on those sort of responses, I thought I'd better tell you how often, or what the dollar per hectare, how things panned out over our sites over the years. So we had a number of sites where in terms of dollars per hectare gross margins, a lot of them, the nils, were as good as you could get. Didn't mean that you lost money with some of the higher treatments, it just weren't any better. Comparison to like 2015, I've mentioned, the salmon gums was a high one, but 2014, not such a good year, and only 10 units of nitrogen, what we just put it on its seeding, was the best one to have done. A couple of sites where 25 to 30, and then only a few where 40 to 50, and so they tended to be, a good medium site like Whittingham Hills, a good medium to almost high, depending on the season, at Eridu and Chapman, basically very similar places, and a very good year at Holt Rock last year. Very good spring for them. So it did respond in terms of a few sites. But a lot of them are at the low end, and that's, again, one of the reasons why we're going to spend a bit of time talking about the lowish ends of our treatments. Now some pickies to give you an idea of how things can respond. So again, this salmon gums trial, as I mentioned, the things really did really well. We got 90-odd percent establishment in these trials. The best establishment I've ever seen in experiments over my, God, nearly 30 years of doing them. Sown in the middle of April, this is the 404. We also had Telfa in this year in the trial. 2 months later, this plot here had 25 units of nitrogen, top dressed as urea, at 4 weeks, and the one next door still hasn't had any nitrogen. That's destined to have 25 units at 12 weeks. So obviously the one on the left looks better, bulkier, greener. You'd be happier with that. Although if you had a paddock of that at that stage, you wouldn't be heartbroken. In the background is the farmer's stingray, which is looking pretty nice as well, sown the same day. This is the day that we actually applied the nitrogen on the plot on the right. So the one on the left is looking obviously better. This is starting to look a bit peaky. At the bottom of the canopy, you've got yellowing and reddening in the leaves. And, you know, if you were advising the farmer to do that sort of treatment and he had some N strips elsewhere, you'd probably be running for the hills. 10 days later, starting to play a bit of catch-up. Still the one on the left is better. But you can see that, well, I can see that it's starting to respond even 10 days later. We get to the spring field day. Mark went on holiday between these two dates, so there weren't too many photos. And this spring field day, not exactly the same plots because we were a bit busy that day, but the same treatments. And basically the plots have really evened up, the treatments have really evened up. The one on the left probably still visually a bit more depth to the pods perhaps, but still that's not something to be sneezed at with that late N application at 12 weeks when the crop was just starting to flower with the Hyola, but right into flowering for the Telfa plots nearby. This is the same plots, back to the original plots that we were looking at harvest. The one on the right actually ends up looking a little bit better. The yields are exactly the same, well, they are statistically the same, and the oils were exactly the same, so there's no difference. So just to show you visually how the crop can recover. In terms of the yields, we had quite a few timings with the 25 of N and the higher at 50 of N, we had split applications, but we just did these timings in 2013, seeding 4, 8 and 12, and salmon gums very flat, as I've mentioned. Holt Rock, it looks like 12 weeks is lower yielding than the others, but statistically there was no difference, the variation there. Meriden, that 12-week treatment is lower yielding with at Meriden, and Libby, I think everyone would agree that they're all the same. Getting onto oil, very similar story. The Holt Rock looks like it should have reduced oil at for 25 event at 12 weeks, but it didn't. A weird thing, the 8-week treatment at Meriden, that's actually lower than the 12-week for oil, and Levy, no difference. Put all these things together, and I've put the nil plots to the right, so that's just to show you that, yes, that is lower, but I've already told you that. Holt Rock, there was no difference, as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk. The nil was as good as anything, but there's no difference between, well, there is no difference in those treatments. And then Meriden, the oil at 8 weeks overrides the loss of grain yield at 12 weeks, so that 8 weeks is the only treatment that's lower yielding. And then at Leiby, everything's the same. So in 2013, basically, applying 25 of N at 12 weeks gave a fairly similar response to the to other timings. What happens at a higher rate? So at the 50 of N, I haven't really got time to go through all the sites, so I've picked one, again, coming back to this salmon gum site, because it actually behaved like if I did a, when I've done a meta-analysis, a multi-site analysis, you get the same sort of story as this trial, where if you put 50 of N, you know, a big dollop of it, so not something that anyone except a mad scientist would do, I think, you do drop the oil. And that is a story that we've seen in quite a number of trials. But if you split the N, so 25 at seeding, 25 at 12 weeks, there was no difference in the oil. I've tried to get my head around why that happened, 0 and 4, and I've gone hunting for whether we had a dilution effect and all that sort of thing happening, but I can't really explain why the oil was slightly lower at 0 and 4 week applications. But grain yield was flatlining, gross margins flatlining, so even with the 50 of N treatments at salmon gums. So, 12 weeks, waiting to put the whole lot at 12 weeks is probably not normal behaviour. It's more likely, you know, when we ask farmers at our field days, you know, and just, you know, chatting to them, most people put some on at seeding, and then 6 to 8 weeks is when they're putting most of their top-up nitrogen on. In some places, like Cogenup, they do it a little bit later, but most places in Western Australia is 6 to 8 weeks. So split applications is more normal, and so we've redesigned the 2014 trials to try and reflect this, and also done the split applications at those lower nitrogen rates to target those, and that's what Sally's going to talk about.
So in 2014, we changed our treatment somewhat in that we got rid of the earlier treatments, the 4-week treatments, in response to talking to growers and consultants and trying to target what they were doing. So they were doing more their top-up nitrogen around 6 to 8 weeks, and 4 weeks was probably a little too early. And it allowed us to reduce our total number of treatments and concentrate on probably where you want to be for low rainfall, so around that 30 units of nitrogen. Overall, we had 22 treatments because we had two varieties. The two varieties that we looked at were Sturt for the TT and Pioneer 43Y23 for the Roundup Ready. And we had different timings for 30, 50 and 70 of N. So just looking at the 30 of N, we had an earlier treatment of 10 at seeding and 20 at 8 weeks, and a later timing of 10 at seeding and 20 at 12 weeks. We had quite a number of trials across the low to medium rainfall zones, with 8 in total, 1 at Meriden, East Bunteen, Una, Salmon Gums, Holt Rock, Chapman, Cunderdon and Wongan Hills. I'll just be concentrating on the 5 in blue. So just looking at this photo taken in early September at our Cunderdon trial with the early treatment on the left and the later treatment on the right, they'd both had all applications of nitrogen at this point and they're looking pretty similar in the growing season. Come harvest time, there was a slightly higher yield in the earlier treatment, but it wasn't significant. When we look at grain yield, there was a response from the nil at both timings at Chapman and at Salmon Gums, and from the nil at 8 weeks at Wongan. But when we look at the two different timings compared to each other, there was only a response at Chapman with a lower grain yield at the 12-week treatment. But in saying that, Chapman was probably one of our higher rainfall sites and probably required something more in the ballpark of 50 to 70. When we look at the two different varieties separated, it was the same story with Chapman, the only one where we saw a reduction in grain yield, a significant reduction in grain yield with both of the varieties. And in terms of oil, when you're putting on your nitrogen, you're running the risk of reducing your oil. It was a little unclear from last year's results if putting that later application on reduced it much more than putting it on earlier, as again, Chapman was the only one where we saw a significant reduction in oil at that later timing. But oil was probably a little bit confused last year in that it was pretty hot during the growing season, and it was definitely different to what we saw in 2013. In terms of gross margins, it illustrates it was probably only worth putting on nitrogen at Chapman and Cunderdin. Cunderdin had the highest gross margins. That was due to a combination of one of the high yielding trials and also had reasonable oils. Una was actually the highest yielding trial, but it had lower oils, so that's reducing that gross margin there, and it also had multiple sprays for aphids, so it's brought it down as well. So in summary, in terms of just looking at that timing at 30 units of N, in terms of grain yield, there was only a response at one of five of the trials, so at Chapman, at that 12 weeks, we saw a reduction in grain yield, and again with the oil at Chapman, a reduction at 12 weeks. And the timing of nitrogen had no effect on gross margin. I'll just pass you back to Mark.
Thanks. Thanks, Sally. Okay, we're just trying to wrap it up with a couple of general statements about what we've learned as a result of doing these experiments. And it's some of it is not new, it's just reiterating stuff that a lot of people already use, but it's worth commenting again for the low rainfall areas that whilst canola growth in particular and biomass and, you know, and this making a cabbage and all that sort of thing does respond to nitrogen and yield does as well. Often the yield, the oil decreases have a overriding effect. You know, back in the day when you weren't getting paid for oil or there was a ceiling on oil, then the sort of comments can be a little bit differently. But now you're getting paid as the oil goes up and losing money as it goes down. And the varieties have inherently better oils than they used to. And of course the cost's going up as you're putting on more nitrogen. And we need to be mindful that in a lot of our experiments, 30 units of nitrogen seems to be about where you want to be. And I think the 10 and 20 split is the way to go. But if you think you're in, and certainly we had a lot of trials where the zero of N dollars per hectare was the place to be. And to be confident of that, you need to use all the tools that are available to you. So, our team mostly use Select Your Nitrogen. We use the Excel-based version. We haven't quite come to grips with the web version of it yet. But there are other ones around. There's a nitrogen app that Plan Farm have done, which is very similar. And, you know, New Logic and those tools, all the ones that use rotation, soil type, expected yields, and, your organic carbons and those sort of things to give you an idea of rates. And I think, you know, people should be using those to really help with that, and maybe some of our data can be included and help to validate some of these things. Certainly the timing on SIN doesn't allow you to go really any later than 8. We still would suggest, and I think most people would probably agree, that splitting it at seeding and then at 6 to 8 weeks is what people do, is still the thing to aim for. But this work just allows them, if conditions are uncertain at that time, like they were for us at Salmon Gums this year in 2014, we really, at 8 weeks, it was really struggle town in terms of moisture. Then at 10 weeks, things turned around and you might have thought about putting on nitrogen. As it turned out, hindsight's a wonderful thing. You would have been better off not putting it on. But just giving people the confidence that if something's mucked up and they haven't got it on 8 weeks, it's not too late to go a bit later, or they can make that decision later, and sometimes the decision may be not to put it on, but if you do decide to put it on, you'll get a fairly similar response. So I think that's what where we're at with that style of work. We are doing a little bit more in the high rainfall with even later N applications. I'm not holding out too much confidence about it, whether that's going to work, but so that's where we're at with our timing of N work.